there are different ways of fishing through all of the stuff on the page and developing an idea about it, developing an interpretation. We can learn a lot by circling the text through a series of different perspectives. Being conscious of this is, I would say, an important strategy. How do I look at this poem from a variety of perspectives? Scholars have done this for, again, thousands of years, so we can sort of follow in their wake in just a few of the basics, not necessarily all of them, but just a few of the basic ways of looking at it. And I want to just consider for a minute the this opening scene of Zeus and Athena. We get a little prologue into the story. We get an invocation to the muses. Imagine a poet who is stepping up to the microphone and he knows he's got to speak for hours, recalling all of this. That's quite daunting. So, you know, you pray to God that somebody's going to help you. So he's praying to the muses for help. But very soon, we're into this little dynamic with Zeus and Athena. And it's curious. Why would they start like this? Why would this be the initial introduction into the story? You can start the story any number of ways. Why this? Always ask that question. Why? What's going on here, and why are they doing it like that? Zeus begins with a complaint. He's bitching and moaning a little bit about these pesky and ungrateful human beings. He dwells on the example of this character, Aegisthus, and the story of this other character, this great Greek general, Agamemnon. This puts a spotlight on the primacy of people moving beyond resentments. Aegisthus and Agamemnon are characters in a story of retribution and vengeance, and how they let their hatreds compel them to horrific acts. And so that story is right at the beginning. It is name-checked immediately. So bearing that in mind, I think, is important. Understanding this is viewing the text through a thematic lens. The broadest perspective of what the text as a whole means in terms of the ideas that it's articulating. In this case, vengeance and resentment and the ability to get beyond that. The discussion between Athena and Zeus offers an awful lot of exposition, backing and filling of, okay, who is this character and what's where is he and what's going on? What's the issue? We learn about Odysseus being an exile. We learn about the support he enjoys from Athena. Athena is like his Athena has his back. Athena is kind of like a guardian angel in this, to draw an example from the Catholic tradition. We learn about the obstacle, the opposition that Odysseus faces, the drama of Poseidon's wrath. Poseidon is the god of the sea. He's got it in for Odysseus. Odysseus is trying to get over the sea, trying to sail home. So having the god of the sea angry at you puts you in a very vulnerable position. So you get that opposition. And you also get an awful lot of foreshadowing, things that are going to happen or that have happened that we're going to learn about later on in the poem. All of this would fall under the heading of a narratological perspective, which focuses on the story, the narrative, and how it is told. But it's also a dramatic frame, a dramatic perspective, which references the twists and turns of the plot and the characters and the opposition and all of that. They're not exactly the same, narratological and dramatic, but they're similar. The distinction between them is kind of important. A dramatic reading generally highlights the what of the telling. You know, what happens. The narratological highlights is more about the way it is told. So you get that that importance of the storyteller articulating what's going on and perhaps arranging the story and presenting the story in a style that conveys more than just the story, but perhaps more of the thematics of it. We also learn an awful lot about the sociological standpoint going on there. We learn about, the confidence with which Homer can name drop Agamemnon. The Agamemnon story was assumed to be known by the audience. Just think about that. If you have to go scurrying through the footnotes, you're not alone in the modern age. We got lots of other stuff going on. But the Homeric poets had great confidence that anybody listening to this story would know about Agamemnon. That shows an awful lot of confidence in a fairly small, arguably closed tribal society. This is especially, I think, instructive in understanding the religious festival aspect of this, where the general where ordinary people come to this, and you get a general profile of the society at large. Everybody who shows up is just an ordinary person. So if you expect that they're going to know this story, then that tells you that just about everybody out in the country even would probably know that story. So you can learn an awful lot about the poem that way. Or the poem can tell you an awful lot about the people and the culture that way. Either way. We can also look at this in terms of something called reader response. The expectation that its audience will understand the Agamemnon reference validates them. It makes them feel good. It creates a kind of coterie culture where you know Agamemnon, I know Agamemnon, so we're all in this together, right? It creates a kind of insider status for everybody. If they start talking about something they have no idea about, well, you know, we've all been there, you feel excluded. You feel, all right, I'm different. I don't know what they're talking about. But if they start talking about something that everybody is familiar with, then that is a deliberate choice as well. The text this way is creating a kind of intimacy with the readers. And even if we don't fall into that camp because we are not in that specific tribe of ancient Greece, we can see them doing it. Understanding why the text makes all these deliberate little decisions is important. But that reader response technique has a kind of psychodynamic aspect as well. The readers, or more specifically in this case, I would say listeners, have to keep up with the reference. It comes pretty soon into the start of the poem. I think Aegisthus is first name dropped where? On like line 15 or so? Maybe like 29, I think. You know, you're settling in for a long performance of a poem. You're probably thinking, yeah, okay, this is just like the previews, this is the introduction, the overture. Yeah, right. They'll take a little while. I don't really have to pay attention just now. And then all of a sudden, oh my God, they're name dropping now. Who is that again? Let me Google that. Whatever Googling was in ancient Greece. That creates a kind of mental challenge to the audience. Maybe they don't have it automatically there. Oh, yeah! Aegisthus! They have to keep a very complicated story in their heads for reference. And introducing it in terms of Aegisthus himself, the first named reference to this story. Agamemnon is a king. Agamemnon is a major character in the Homeric world. Aegisthus is kind of a supporting player. He does not show up in Homer at all. He is a figure in the mythology of Greece, but he's a backbencher. And I'm not going into the specifics of the story, which is horrible, quite frankly. But you know, why Aegisthus? Somebody who knows the story real well and has all that information is going to be right on it. Oh yeah, Aegisthus is this guy. Somebody else might go, who? What? What? Oh, Agamemnon. Yeah. Think about what that does on a reader response level. It creates a kind of panic. It's a challenge to bear all of those details in your head as all this new information is coming at you, which is a central motif of Odysseus's journey throughout this story. He is an intellectual guy, a smart guy, not necessarily intellectual, but a smart guy. And he lives by his wits. He's not the strongest of the Greek heroes. He is the smartest of them. This whole poem, the whole story, is about him being challenged to use his intelligence, to figure things out, to outsmart his opponents, to achieve his goal. So that sense of being confused, that sense of being under stress, actually puts the reader in Odysseus's shoes at the beginning. Listeners and ultimately readers end up viscerally experiencing the core drama of the protagonist before the protagonist even really appears, creating a kind of identification. Those little notes start to add up to a remarkably subtle way of bringing the readers into the drama. So it's not just them sort of listening to this happened and that happened and this happened and that happened, but making them experience it on a gut level. Because of this, I think you can say, because everybody is supposed to be feeling this sense of being Odysseus, and Odysseus isn't even on the scene yet. In a certain way, then, everybody, all of society, everybody listening to this poem, everybody who has ever felt that sense of anxiety about understanding a lot of confusing details in the world, everybody is the protagonist. Odysseus just becomes a representative of humanity at large. That Greek society itself is the hero of this story. But there is a rhetorical frame of this scene that is equally fascinating. It's a debate. Athena and Zeus are having a little argument. She is trying to persuade him of something. Zeus and Athena begin their respective remarks by agreeing with one another, which is a very diplomatic move. Yes, I agree. It is A beautiful day out today. You are absolutely right. Gratifying one another in that way, and then launching into their attack. This is what polite people do in diplomacy, quite frankly. And that's what this is. This is a diplomatic exchange, a governmental exchange, almost. This is a patriarch, a monarch, talking to his daughter, another powerful goddess. But there is that official business frame to it. This is Mount Olympus. This is the royal divine court. And they are conducting a public debate, almost, about, well, it starts off with, again, Zeus just sort of griping and complaining about how human beings are ungrateful and annoying, and Athena using that to turn Zeus to support the one human that she actually likes, which is Odysseus. There's all sorts of layers of irony developed into that. But you can also see that the debate itself is an example of the limitations or the contrast of Greek divinity as opposed to, let's say, the Hebraic tradition. Because all of these, and this is more of a religious frame, but all of these different distinctions between them are very significant. The Greeks don't believe in a single god. They believe in many, many gods, a polytheistic society where the gods argue among themselves. They are all limited in their powers, so they often need one another to cooperate to achieve anything. They can all do like one good thing, but in order to achieve large projects, they have to work together. And you see that Athena needs her father's power, her father's authority, and she needs to turn that, argue for it, towards her own end. The Hebraic tradition is very different. We saw that in Genesis, where God, the one monotheistic God, just says, I want this, and there it is. You know? These gods are very different. This is a religious way of interpreting what they are doing here. That notion of the single god, however, that is open to debate and movable, malleable by other forces, is troubling in a political frame. If we posit, as I think is clear, that Zeus is a kind of authoritarian monarch, almost a tyrant. That's a very loaded and highly debated term. Complaining about his subjects from his, you know, remote perch at the absolute apex of the social hierarchy. It's a troubling contrast to the Hebrew tradition because he does not have that much power. He is being swayed by the forces around him. The other gods can move him to do things kind of, oh yeah, okay, well, we'll do that now. It's not an overriding law of the universe that he's exercising. It's not a, you know, enormous notion of truth that he is articulating. It's just all kind of a whim. So you get a very capricious and chaotic universe as a result. The Greeks saw the universe around them as insensible. They didn't know what to make of it. They were just confused and felt vulnerable by it, which again mirrors the image of Odysseus just being buffeted around by fate. Doesn't know how to handle it. That is a essential understanding of the political context at play here. the Greeks saw the universe as hostile, as opposed to the Hebrews, where God defines everything created as good. 7 days of creation. He did this and it was good. He did this and it was good. In the Greek tradition, it is much more about being knocked hither and thither by a universe that makes no sense and is often just an expression of selfishness and chaos, quite frankly. This is all essentially also an allegorical reading, where Zeus is not just the god, but a representative of government, of human political leaders. Whether or not this interpretation endorses or criticizes this political model is a matter of great scholarly debate. Is it good that Zeus is up there in charge of everything, or is he not the strong figure that you might think, but a rather silly one because he thinks he's so strong, but really, you know, he's just being led around by the nose by his daughter. There's an allegorical interpretation there, too, where it's not Zeus just Zeus, but Zeus as a representative of other political leaders. And you might say, well, why didn't Homer just write a poem about political leaders and, you know, contemporary leaders of his time? Well, artists have done that from time to time, and a lot of them end up thrown out of windows in debt. So you can see the reason why they might want to hide behind a little mask there. Part of that relationship between Zeus and Athena is also it's also instructive to look at it from a kind of a gender thematic perspective, where Zeus is, you know, the patriarch. He is the guy's guy. He is the ultimate dead white male, if you will, eternally living white male. However you want to count that. And Athena is his daughter and also a female. Not technically a woman. She's a goddess, but she is a female. So you've got this gender dynamic between them, this generational dynamic between him. I think it's clear that he is in charge from his throne, just up there talking about things. And his daughter is coming to him as a kind of a supplicant, saying, okay, Dad, we gotta work this out. Now, you know, she is trying to sway him. She needs his power. She is clearly in the inferior position throughout the scene, arguing from a lower status of gender and generation. But she prevails. Now, this is where the gender dynamic gets really interesting, especially comparatively. She prevails. She gets what she wants from her father. She does take him by the nose and lead him to what she wants, ultimately. Part of this is, from a character study, a sign that, well, Athena is kind of his favorite, and you can go off on that. But just think about what that means on an allegorical level, on a representational level, where you're not sure exactly what it means, but you get a sense. And here, the sense can be good or bad. Athena is a woman who sways a man, and everything that follows in this story, all of the human suffering that develops, all of the catastrophe that evolves, it all stems from this moment of a female coercing a male authority figure. And again, you don't have to go very deep into Genesis to see Adam and Eve. And Eve swaying Adam and the entire history of humanity results. That sense of a power dynamic, I would say, is really instructive. Is it a good thing that she coerces her father to do as she wants? Odysseus gets home in the end. Spoiler alert. Or is it a bad thing because there is an awful lot of body bags along the way? There's a lot of suffering that happens. Is it good or is it bad? Are women troublesome? Are women part of the problem? Do they just make everything worse by acting? Why can't they just stay in the kitchen and look after the kids and get me my dinner on the table at 6 o'clock? Or is it good that Zeus has this wise female perspective guiding him along? Zeus doesn't necessarily come out very well here. He comes out kind of like a pompous jackass, just full of himself. Perhaps, you know, assuming great authority, but in the end, she has more power than he does because she changes his mind. She gets him to do what she wants. That motivation is, well, that's power. So all of these different perspectives, all of these are different angles on a scene that only lasts a couple of lines here, a couple of pages, tops. Well, it's more on this page than in the anthology, but different ways of looking at it, different ways of cracking into what might seem just like an ordinary scene that you're not sure what's going on. It's like, oh, okay, Just try looking at these things from very particular angles, based on very particular questions. What is the dynamic between the characters? Why am I being told this at this point? What is the purpose of starting here as opposed to this other scene that's going to come up in a couple of pages, which would seem like so much more drama inherent? Why? And if you just start going through, you know, at first some simple box step critiques, which are just sort of pre-formulated, and you'd say, okay, if I were to look at it from a reader response theory, I can ask this question. If I were to look at it from an historical or a religious or a sociological perspective, I can get this out of it. You're never going to get the whole thing. You're never going to get everything that is, you're never going to get all of the meaning that is in this poem, quite frankly. People have tried, they die way before they can. The more they read it, the more they realize, I am never going to finish this poem. Like I said, I have read it an awful lot of times, and I am still like, whoa, where did that come from? Because, you know, I'm older and grayer now, so I am a different person coming to it. But for your purposes, getting through it in those early stages, just try on all of these different questions if you find yourself a little lost. It is a good page-turner adventure, and you can read it on that way. And when you're doing that, you can think about how everybody who shows up for the performances of this at the festivals, they were just sitting there in the lawn chairs. You know, they got their beer and they're cozy and they're just sitting there and they're letting the entertainment sway over them. That is one way of taking this. That is one way of going about this. And you can draw all sorts of conclusions and meanings out of that. But you can bring in these other questions as well that just add so much more. And then they also lead to other questions. The minute you start in on this, you're pulling on a thread that you can follow into eternity, quite frankly. That alternating your perspectives, the switching around from a different toolkit, if you will, can jumpstart the process of reading, of making meaning, of decoding, if you want to call it that. This is what reading is, figuring it out. What the hell is going on here? It's the same issue, you know, that you've had since your parents first put you in their lap and opened up, brown bear, what can you see? Or, you know, any one of those Dr. Seuss books or whatever you want. That process of seeing something and saying, well, what is that? What does that mean? Well, what is that? If you can do that, if you can just click through some of these ideas and have the confidence to crack open the book and start digging in with these preformed ideas or not, if you can do that, you can read absolutely anything from any time period, in any language, in any culture, anything, if you just go about it as a simple inquiry.